Good morning.
Good morning.
Are y'all awake?
Yes.
I mean, I know it's Labor Day weekend. It's a holiday weekend, right? Let's try this again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, fabulous. I love to hear that you're awake and with us this morning. So glad that you're here worshiping with us this morning. And I just want to welcome each and every one of you. And to thank you for making that choice to get out of bed and get here on a holiday weekend to praise our Heavenly Father and our awesome Creator. If you would join me in prayer. Holy and gracious God, it is a privilege and an honor to come into this house with the awareness that you are here. You welcome us, and you are with us as we recognize your majesty, as we recognize your mercy and your love. God, let the words of our mouths as we sing and we pray, and let the meditations of our hearts this day be pleasing to you. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear, Lord, that your people are gathered to worship and give thanks to you, our Creator. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
I'm Jan Lowe, Minister of Congregational Care. I want to welcome everyone here this morning. We're so glad that you're here. If you're a guest with us, we want you to know how pleased we are that you are worshiping with us this morning. If you are a guest for the first time, we have a gift we'd like to share with you. We need your help to make that happen. Before you leave this morning, if you will stop at the narthex at the desk there, just give us your name and address. When we have that, someone will stop by your home this week. They will drop off a mug that is yours to keep. That mug is going to have information in it that tells about the many ministries and the many ways that we have in our church to serve our Lord, to serve people in our community and beyond, and to serve one another. And you know, we want everybody to enjoy the fellowship that is in this place today. We do have attendance pads. I'm sure they've been passed. If someone new has come into the row that you're in, pass them one more time. Your signature lets us know that you were here, but it also helps us to figure out who might not have been able to be here. And with that kind of information, we can do a better job of staying in touch with our church family. So thank you for helping us with that. If you will open your bulletins to ministry opportunities and events, I've got just a couple of things that I would like to cover. The first one is the bazaar. We talk about the bazaar all year long. The bazaar is less than a month away. So if you've been making things at home, it's time to bring them in. If you'd like to know how you can help, check the United Methodist Women's Bulletin Board in Becker Hall. And if you really just want the whole story, read this month's newsletter, and all of it's in there. Disciple and Discovery is a Bible study class that begins on Tuesday, September 8th. So that is something that Reverend Albert Fisher is leading, and we hope that you will remember to come to that, call the church office and make a reservation, but just show up if you don't get a chance to do that. I want to remind everyone that the Monday night class, the Journey Through Grief, will not meet tomorrow night, and so they will resume again the next Monday. So we hope that you get that message. The last thing I want to tell you about is United Methodist Men. This is their regular monthly meeting that's coming up this Wednesday night. Somehow the phone tree didn't get done, and so we're asking all the men that are here, there's little yellow tabs in the pew in front of you. If you will just grab one of those little yellow pieces of paper, write your name on it, and put UMM, put it in the offering plate, and that's how we're going to count how many meals to order for the dinner that's this Wednesday night. So please, men, if you will do that, I know you usually have a different way of handling that, but that's the way we're going to do it this month, and we appreciate your help with that. God bless, and thank you.
Thank you. please remain standing and join with me in our historic statement of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
God is good
all the time.
And all the time. As we greet one another this morning and help one another to feel welcome in this place, remember that your handshake and your hug is passing the love and the peace of Christ as you greet one another. Let us greet one another with signs of reconciliation and love. Thank you.
Good morning. Our scripture lesson this morning is from the epistle to James, chapter 1, verses 19 to 21. Listen to the word of God, and I'm reading from the New King James Version. So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. This is the word of God for the people of God.
As the ushers prepare to come forward, may we reflect on God's ways in our lives. May we listen and hear the voice of God as we give our offerings back to Him who speaks in our lives. God of light, God of truth, God who speaks in our lives, We thank you that you are present with us, and we ask that you help us listen for your guidance in all of your ways. Lord, we offer these gifts back to you in praise and thanksgiving, and ask that you use these to build your kingdom and for your glory. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. We have come to the time where we share in the joys and concerns of our church family and lift those up to our Lord. We have just a whole wealth of joys this morning. Certainly, the first I will mention is we have a whole pew full of the Bacon family. Karen's birthday is in a couple of weeks. She said it was okay to say that it will be her 70th birthday, and they are here to celebrate that. How wonderful to have your family all together. That just fills the mother's heart. I know. So welcome to all of you. During the week will also be the 54th wedding anniversary of Frank and Marilyn Kutz, if I pronounced that right, I'm sorry if I didn't. And they will make a donation to the sound system, and we thank them for that in honor of their wedding anniversary. Also, within the week, Norma McLean, who is a resident at Highlands, will have her 93rd birthday. And that donation will also be made in her honor as well. And she is just a joy out there. I was talking to Gladys a little while ago, and she said that the staff there fight over which hall she should live on because she's just such a joy to be able to provide nursing for. So what a blessing that is. We're thankful that we have people back from Sager Brown, and I know it was a wonderful, wonderful visit, and we thank you for your service in the Lord's name. There were just inspirational things that happened there as well. And we're thankful also for a holiday weekend, a weekend to be able to get a break a little bit, and that's where Brother Jamie is. He is down at the beach and just having a wonderful time. He posted a picture of his morning's view as he looks out over the ocean and across the dunes and the sand and whatnot, and it was just wanted to be there. I hesitate to use that word jealous because we're told not to do that. He said so just a couple of weeks ago, but oh my, what a wonderful way to spend the holiday weekend. We do have concerns as well. The beautiful flowers here are from the service for Sybil Martin, which was held yesterday. Her family, a big family, was here yesterday in celebration of her life, and we ask that you continue to lift that family in your prayers. There's also a carnation on the altar that we have placed in her memory. And the second carnation is for Emma Rose Jennings. She passed away a week ago Saturday. And her service will be held in Wichita at a later date. So keep those families in your prayers. We have had several folks who were in the hospital during the week and have fortunately been able to go home. Ralph Johnson had eye surgery, but he is at home at this time. Shirley Davenport was in the hospital for some testing, but she is home at this time. And Julie Booker had some cancer surgery this week. So she is home as well. Keep all of those in your prayers, please. Unfortunately, we do still have some folks who are in the hospital. I don't know if you know the Antoines. They worship in the well service at 9:30. But their little one, Emery, is in Arkansas Children's Hospital. She has had some malignant tumors removed from her abdomen. She will stay there for a while they continue to diagnose and receive treatments in the aftermath of that surgery. So please keep her and the family, her parents, Ashley and Dylan, in your prayers as well. Bob Shaw has, we've heard from Jan, and the two of them have traveled to Omaha, where he will undergo kidney surgery this week at the medical center there. That surgery is to be held on Wednesday, so please keep that in your prayers. And we know that Dale Veach is in Northwest Bentonville. At this point, we don't have any further information, but as that information is provided, we will let you know how Dale is doing. So please keep Dale and Nancy in your prayers as well. We always lift up a church in the Bella Vista area. And this morning, the church that we're lifting is one that is especially dear to us. The Bella Vista Community Church has been going through some struggles lately. And we are told at this point that that there is healing going on there, and we're so thankful for that. So please continue to pray for them, that their church will continue to receive healing, that those who have reunited will be able to become a family again. And for those who, there were a number who found shelter in the storm here with us, and a number who became part of our church family as a result of the difficulties over there. So pray for all of them. We're so thankful that the Lord has been in this and healing is coming. Know that there will be a complete list of prayer concerns at the back of the sanctuary as you leave. Feel free to pick up one of those as you leave the worship service. And now may we join our hearts and our minds in prayer together. Holy and gracious God, we come to you this day with the challenges of the world rolling around inside of us. We have been pulled in so many different directions, and Lord, we often do not listen for your voice amongst all the chaos. And yet you send your Holy Spirit to be present in our lives, to show us your truth and your light. Lord, forgive us when we turn away from that truth, from that presence. Forgive us when we grow angry and frustrated and lash out at others and ourselves just because we're trying to do it all alone. Help us instead, Lord, to listen, and help us to hear your voice. Jesus, you came to be with us in the flesh. When we were still sinners, you left the comfort of heaven to walk among us. You came to show us forgiveness, to grant us forgiveness, to reconcile us back to you and to each other. Help us, Lord, to be slow to speak, to have ears to listen, and to be quick to forgive, just as you forgive us. Lord, we give you thanks for family gatherings, for birthdays, for anniversaries, for the wonderful things, the fellowship and the travel that have gone on in this holiday weekend. And Lord, we ask for your healing touch upon those who have been in the hospital and have gone home, upon those who are still in the hospital. We ask that you be with the doctors and the nurses and the medicines that are given, that they will help to heal the body just as your healing touch heals the body and the spirit. Lord, we thank you for our many blessings and for the healing that you provide in our lives. We ask that you instill in us a heart that seeks you in all things. We pray that you will send your Holy Spirit to rest upon Pastor Judy as she delivers the message that you have placed on her heart this week. May each of us listen and hear the words that you know are intended just for us. Thank you for this message that we're about to hear. We know that this message will inspire us in your ways, in your truth, and in your light. Gracious God, we lift these prayers and all the unspoken prayers that are on each of our hearts to you this day. And may we join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Well, today we continue in our sermon series, The Game. And as you all may be aware, we have been looking at the team Deadly Sins versus the team Heavenly Virtues. And we've looked at, over the last few weeks, we've looked at pride versus humility and greed versus generosity. And last week, we looked at the one that Brenda mentioned as she was referring to Brother Jamie being in on the beach was envy versus kindness. don't know about you all, maybe it's just me, but it seems like I've had more opportunities to be aware of these deadly sins working in my life. Has anybody else noticed that over the last few weeks? It's just irritating as all get out. But you know, a couple of weeks ago when I heard Brother Jamie talking and preaching about the coaches for each team, the coach for deadly sins that tries to tempt us and persuade us to engage in those deadly sins, and the coach for heavenly virtues that is trying to persuade us and guide us into living a virtuous life, I was struck. I was reminded of a particular author, C.S. Lewis, and a book that he wrote. Perhaps you all are familiar with C.S. Lewis. If you're not, just let me tell you, he was a brilliant scholar. He taught English literature first at Oxford and then at Cambridge in England. And for much of his life, he was a devout atheist. But during his life, at some period in his life, he had a conversion experience. And he became a very strong Christian. And he wrote a number of books, some of which you may be familiar with. The Screwtape Letters, or Mere Christianity. That book is, in particular, talks about the doctrines of Christianity from the perspective of a lay person. And probably the one that we're most familiar with, because now it has been made into a movie, would be The Chronicles of Narnia. But I was struck as I heard Brother Jamie speaking. It reminded me of the book The Screwtape Letters. And some of you all may be familiar with this particular book. It's written from the perspective of the coach of the deadly sins. And it's written from one demon who is coaching an apprentice demon, in which he is attempting to teach him how to make his subject, the human being that he is assigned to, engage and follow the deadly sins. He talks about manipulation and controlling the thinking of the human subject in order to engage in the deadly sins. It's actually quite an insightful look at our human nature and our bent towards the deadly sins. Now, of course, we know as he's going through the deadly sins, of course, he brings up anger. And C.S. Lewis has an interesting take on anger. He talks about it in terms of not so much the events that happen in our life, the things that make us angry, perhaps the mistakes we made or the mishaps that occur, but our perspective and our attitude as we go into those situations, and how our sense of ownership and entitlement is what causes us to become angry, not the events themselves. This can be kind of confusing, so let me give you a couple of examples. Take sports, for example. Whether it be a golf game, or perhaps it's your favorite team, the Arkansas Razorbacks. When we go into a sporting event or a competitive event, we kind of size up our opposition, right? We kind of look at them and see how we think they're going to do. And so we have an expectation of how we are going to do in competition with them. And, you know, really, this isn't limited to just sports. It could be taking a test, preparing for a test. It could be a game of cards. But we have this idea of how things are going to turn out, what the outcome is going to be. And when things don't turn out the way that we expect them to turn out, the way we anticipate that they should turn out, we can become upset and angry. Another example is time. I know all of us have had things in our lives where we've planned events. Maybe it's a visit from relatives. Perhaps it's a dinner out with our spouse or a really good friend. Or perhaps it is a vacation, a long-awaited and deserved vacation. And something happens. Maybe it's a phone call. Someone is in need. Perhaps it is an illness that occurs, and it interrupts our plans. And we can become agitated and irritated, even angry, that our plans have been thwarted, that our desire for what we thought needed to happen in our lives has been interfered with. And the thing about it is, if we had not had that expectation, if we had not had that thought that we deserved or were entitled, then perhaps we would not have found ourselves getting angry. I wonder what would happen if, in instances like that, instead of looking at our lives as things that we were entitled to or we deserved, if we looked at everything as a gift. Aren't our lives a gift? Isn't our very breath a gift? Aren't our families and our friends, aren't our events that we love to do, the things that we love to do, are those not a gift? You see, that coach for the team Deadly Sins, that coach wants us to think that we deserve life to be a certain way. That coach wants us to have ownership in our time and our activities. Because when we do and things are disrupted, then where do we fall? We fall into that deadly sin of anger. You know, both of our scripture readings for today, the one from James that Alan read for us earlier, and the one from Proverbs, which I'm about to read, talk about human nature. They talk about our human condition, and they give us guidance and direction on what and how we should live in order to lead a godly life. The passage from James talks about everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. You know, if we are looking at everything as a gift, if we're looking at our lives and our opportunities as gifts, then would we not be slower to reach anger whenever things did not go the way we anticipated, when they didn't go the way that we planned? Our passage from Proverbs today that I'm getting ready to read for you, I looked at in light of this. And in fact, all this week as I've been meditating and thinking about the sermon, I've been looking at the little things that happened during the week that gave me the opportunity to look at the deadly sin of anger. And I found in almost every situation that happened, when I would feel myself getting a little anxious or a little upset, I found that in that situation, if I had not had an expectation that things were going to go my way and that I was going to have control over the events of the day, then I wouldn't have gotten anxious. I wouldn't have gotten upset over the way things turned out. So as I read this passage from Proverbs, listen. Listen for how those people that are angry and practicing anger and the deadly sin of anger, how they have themselves perhaps had ownership in the way things were going. Proverbs 29, 6 through 11. Evildoers are snared by their own sin. But the righteous shout for joy and are glad. The righteous care about justice for the poor, but the wicked have no such concern. Mockers stir up a city, but the wise turn away anger. If a person goes to court with a fool, the fool rages and scoffs, and there is no peace. The bloodthirsty hate a person of integrity and seek to kill the upright. Fools give full vent to their rage, but the wise bring calm in the end. Now, don't get me wrong. I am not saying that it is not okay to get angry. I think there are times when indeed our anger motivates us to help others. When we see an injustice, when we see someone who is denied access to medical care or to education, when we see somebody who is oppressed, perhaps our anger over that situation can motivate us to advocate on their behalf. Even Jesus got angry, as you will recall. In the temple, when he saw that the money changers were taking advantage of the people who had come there to worship. But we have to be careful not to hide behind our righteous anger. I've heard people say, well, I get angry and I blow up and then I get over it. Has anybody here said that before? But you know, the thing about it is, the shrapnel has already flown from the explosion, and the injury cannot be undone. And you know, the thing about anger is, when we hold on to it, it festers. And it infects us. It turns into resentment and bitterness. I like to think of that as we, those of us who are angry, take the poison waiting for the other person to die. So, you know, if we look at changing our perspective, we look at life with gratitude, rather than ownership or expectation or entitlement, we can begin to slow our response to anger. And you may be saying, okay, Judy, that's fine and well, but what happens when we really do have a reason to be angry? What happens when we have been injured and we have been harmed, and what do we do then? Well, Coach Heavenly Virtue is telling us that we need to forgive. We need to follow the example of Christ and forgive one another. I always think of Peter when I think of forgiveness. And I just, you know, I don't know about you guys, but I can so relate to Peter. Sometimes he's such a hothead. You know, he just jumps in and says stuff before he thinks about it. He compares, but his heart is so pure. His heart is where it needs to be. And so when Jesus comes up with this topic and the subject of forgiveness, he says to him, how many times do I have to forgive? Seven? Jesus says, no. 70 times seven. And can't you just see Peter standing there going, 490 times? But you know, the point is, we forgive until we no longer think about forgiving. So how do we do this? I'm one of those very practical persons. I read the scripture, but then it's like, okay, God, how do we carry this out? What are you calling us to do? You know, one of the ways that we can move towards forgiveness is to apply the golden rule. To treat others as we want to be treated. that person that needs forgiveness? How can we extend grace and love and mercy that we want to receive? How can we extend it to them? Perhaps if they are sick, we can take them a meal, or we can call and check on them. If they are lonely, we can offer them a word of encouragement or hope. I'm not saying that forgiveness is easy. I'm saying it takes us, we have to get outside our comfort zones to do this. But we can act as if we have already forgiven them until we get to the point that we have forgiven them. Of course, another way to do this is through prayer. Praying for the person who we feel has wronged us or injured us in some way. I want to give you a real-life example of using both of these things. Back when I was an attorney, I had a coworker who had agreed to take a conference call with a judge for me. And the time came, and he was on the phone with a friend, and so he didn't take the conference call. Well, you can imagine, the judge got upset with me, the parties were upset with me, and yes, I got angry. I was right, wasn't I? I had a right to be angry. He hadn't done what he said he was going to do. I prayed about it, and I thought, you know, I need to go confront in this kind of loving way. And so I told him that I was disappointed and I was hurt and that I was having trouble trusting him. And he proceeded to curse me. I mean, really, curse me. Well, God was not content with me remaining in my anger and my disappointment. And so I began to pray for him, not once a day, but twice a day. And at first, the best I could do was say, God bless him. Because you see, I didn't really mean it, and I really didn't care. But I did it anyway. But as time went on, and I continued that practice, my prayers became more sincere. Now, this was difficult because, mind you, any time I saw him at the office with a group of people, he would acknowledge everybody else in the office except me. He would not speak to me. It was as if I was invisible, as though I didn't exist. But I continued my prayers. And after about 30 days, I received another nudge from the Holy Spirit that just praying for him wasn't enough. Now I needed to speak to him. And I'm like, God, are you kidding me? You just keep pushing the envelope, don't you? But you know, I did. I began to extend to him the same kindness that I wanted extended to me. And over time, he didn't change. But I did. To the point that I no longer even thought about the fact that I needed to forgive him. We worship a risen Lord who has forgiven all of us, who loves us and desires for us to be reconciled to Christ and to one another. Will you this week accept the invitation? Find the opportunities in your life where you are being called to forgive. And will you begin to take the steps to forgive? Will you pray with me? Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for the awareness, Lord, that we are tempted, mightily tempted by sin. But we give you thanks even more for the knowledge and the assurance that you are with us, that you are guiding us, and directing us. You are wooing us and beckoning us into a virtuous, faith-filled life. Show us this week how we can forgive those who we feel have injured or wronged us, that we may truly reflect your love, your mercy, and your grace. It is in Jesus' precious name that we pray. This morning we have the opportunity to come to the table. We come to this table of love and forgiveness. We come with repentant hearts, seeking the mystery of the meal that is before us. As we come, I invite you to join with me in the prayer of confession. Almighty God, you who shaped out of nothing all that is, forgive us for returning empty-handed. You who called forth light, forgive our preference for the dark. You who sent John to be a voice crying, forgive our unwillingness to say anything at all. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
This morning I join you long distance. I'm on a trip with my parents. It's just my parents and myself. The first time in my adult life that I've had the privilege of going on a trip with them, and we're in South Alabama. But I also gather with you as we celebrate Holy Communion, remembering what our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has done for us as he prepared his disciples that one day he would go away. And you remember, as I do, that he gathered with his disciples at a table in an upper room. And in the holiness of that moment, he took bread, and he broke the bread, and he gave that to them and invited them to take and partake of the bread and do so in remembrance of him. And also on that holy night, he took a cup that was before him. He presented it to the disciples. He invited them to drink of the cup and to drink in remembrance of him. For he is the new covenant that makes us one. He is the new covenant that offers us life. He's the new covenant that offers to us salvation, redemption, and forgiveness of sins. And so together, as we gather in Holy Communion on this beautiful morning, made beautiful because of the presence of the Lord, we invite God through his Holy Spirit to bless the bread and to bless the cup. And may they be for us the body and blood of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. And may he make us one into a ministry unto all the world, so that we can go out into a world that is our home, a world that is our environment, our world that is our work life, our world that is our school life, whatever our world is, and bear the good news of the love of Jesus Christ. So as God blesses the cup and as God blesses the bread, God blesses us with the powerful presence of his Son, and you're invited to partake and come to the table.
Thanks be to God. Let me serve you first. If our ushers would please come forward. The body of Christ, Brenda, broken for you. The cup of salvation. Let us pray. Holy and amazing God, God of mystery, God of grace, God of mercy, God of forgiveness, we give you thanks for this meal this morning, for the opportunity to gather at your table, all of us, side by side, basking in the forgiveness of your love. Let this table that we have participated in today, where we have feasted, let it nourish our bodies and our spirits, that we may be renewed in our love for you and for one another, and that we may go into the world a renewed people. It's in Jesus' precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. As we sing our last hymn, Breathe on Me, of number 420 in our hymnal, you're invited to come forward if you did not have an opportunity to pray at the chancel rail, to pray. If you are looking for a church home and you are feeling moved to become a part of this church, we invite you to come forward this morning and proclaim your desire. Let us together raise our voices in gratitude as we sing hymn number 420, Breathe on Me. We want to welcome two of our newest members to our church, Roger and Allison Totten. Where are you? There they are, back there. Welcome them as you depart, and embrace them as brothers and sisters in Christ, as our newest members to our church. And recall and remember that as we go into the world, we aren't called to just come to church, but we are called to
be the church.
Amen.